final Jay.
Yes.
Of the week. Do your thing. Do your thing. I said it, but do
yeah,
it.
I would appreciate that. This is go my ahead. Last this time, Adam. Don't steal my goddamn moment, bro. Hello, everybody, and welcome to Blue Jays Today, where we always have something to say about the Toronto Blue Jays. I'm your host, Nicholas Blaylog.
And I'm your host, Adam Puddle. And yeah, today, guys, this is a different day than any other day. Toronto Blue Jays did not make the playoffs. We're going to talk about that week, but we're also going to talk about everything else around baseball because there's people who did. And it wouldn't be a show unless we talk about the exciting things. So before we get into it, guys, make sure to drop a like, subscribe, and comment down below and let us know everything about that. Today, Jays is our code for Monkey Knife Fight and Manscaped. Use those discounts that you're going to see throughout the video,
do
all
it.
That stuff, so you can help support the channel.
Would appreciate.
All right, Nick. So. Are you
okay,
feeling
bro.
About this wild card race?
Okay.
Obviously, came down to literally a Devers go-ahead two-run bomb.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts about that?
Well, I mean, my thoughts are, God damn it. My thoughts are also, hey, GG Red Sox,
man.
GG Yankees.
That's all you can say, really,
well,
right?
At the end of the day, they were the better team.
Yeah.
They were just a more complete team, which seems ridiculous to say, because when you look at some of the statistics, you think, hey, the Blue Jays were pretty bloody complete.
Yeah.
But it doesn't really matter what you did on paper. It matters what you do at those clutch moments.
Yeah.
And Devers was clutched today, which will be yesterday when you guys see this.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, to score that two-run home run right there, I think it was in the
ninth.
Top of the ninth, excuse me, to take that two-run lead. And then also, too, the Yankees, right, winning out the game where they really needed to the most. Like, they put the pressure on them, but then Aaron Judge
with the clutch single. You know, and I wanted to comment about that, actually. I thought about this earlier. And, like, they had a base open, runners on second and third, and there was one out, I believe. And I'm wondering why they didn't just put Aaron Judge on. I don't know.
Right.
Like, the winning, all that matters is the runner at third. So if you put the runner on, you get the force play, you get double play. But, I mean, that's
you
just me being
absolutely
sad.
Right. And I mean, I think the Rays could have maybe done things differently.
Maybe should have, would have cut them.
But from their perspective, too, right, like, they're probably not putting so much thought into this. Like,
no,
I mean, they'd love to, like, sit back and relax and watch the Yankees struggle and whatnot.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, they punched their ticket, like, a week ago, right?
Yep.
So
yep.
They were all set. They didn't need to think too much about that. And they lost a game. Doesn't mean a whole lot to them.
Mm.
They still get to sit back and relax and watch
the
Yankees struggle. However, won't be in game 163. It will be up against the Boston Red Sox, dude. So taking a look at that, I did want to take a look kind of just a little bit about these teams with this year.
Please.
You know, and it's like looking at OPS, the Red Sox were actually way better than I realized. Third in the entire league in OPS.
Damn, that is a lot better than I realized. I didn't think they were that high.
No, me either, dude. And I remember at the beginning of this year, like, obviously we were talking about the lineup and we said, hey, like, they have maybe the best top four in baseball, arguably, like, very, very good.
Yeah.
But clearly they had some contributions from across the board to finish third in all of MLB. So, I mean, good on you, Red Sox.
Yeah.
And then when you look at their ERA, they finished 15th. So, I mean,
that's wild, man. That's wild because we have here's the thing. Again, the results matter.
The
92
results.
Wins, 91 wins versus the Blue Jays. But we were, like, what, first?
We were
first in OPS and 10th
in ERA.
And they're less in both categories. But at the end of the day, it's like, are you clutch? And Devers was. That's a prime example.
If you had to go based on a clutch factor, obviously the Red Sox did outbeat the Toronto Blue Jays.
Yeah.
But I mean, still, like, a very good season from them across the board. Like, this is, I would argue, playoff worthy, right?
Yeah.
I think ours is also definitely playoff worthy. But, like, this also got the job done.
Yeah,
so.
Like, obviously the 15th in ERA isn't what you'd want to see from a playoff team. Like, when you really look at the top best pitching staffs in baseball, all those teams are playoff teams, usually.
Yeah.
So that's really, you know, for me, no offense, Red Sox fans, like, I do think, that's a good transition question. Who do you think's going to win the wildcard game? Because we have Garrett Cole versus Eovaldi.
Let me tell you first, though, about what the Yankees did.
Okay,
because you're talking about their ERA.
Okay,
they were far superior in that category.
Yeah,
they
finished
sixth in team ERA, which was honestly,
that's
again,
really good.
Pretty good. And also kind of shocking to me because,
it is.
Once again, preseason, we were looking at those Yankees and we were saying, hey, like, Garrett Cole and friends.
Yeah.
And I mean, like, Garrett Cole had a good year. one of a, kind of a down year for him after the whole sticky substance in the second half of the year. But he was still very good. But they had contributions in that bullpen from some other guys. Corey Kluber was really nice, and they had some other starters doing well. So sixth in ERA.
And Montgomery really became solid. Jordan Montgomery really became a guy.
He did, dude.
Their bullpen was really solid. Mm-hmm. Johnny, I don't even know how to pronounce his name. Yeah. Weisiger.
Lasagna.
I call him Lasagna because it's easier. Lasagna. Yeah. King stepped up near the end. So they did have some good contributions throughout the season, up and down. But yeah.
And on the batting side of things, 13th in team OPS. Now, I would argue, I think that some of those statistics are really being brought down by the first half.
Yeah, they were like 22nd or some
shit. They were pretty bad in that first half of the year, but obviously we've seen in the second half with Judge being elite still, Stanton rediscovering
really
it
on.
And then, you know, those acquisitions at the trade deadline of Rizzo, of Gallo, like that's probably helped them out a lot, and they have jumped up. So those are what they've done this year. Who do you have?
Yeah, so with that being said, let's look at the matchup of Eovaldi versus Cole. Mm-hmm. Now, Cole, season-long ERA, 3.23 ERA. Eovaldi, 3.75. But I want to look at the month of September because
Cole... What have you done for me lately?
Cole has been horrible.
He's been pretty bad, dude.
5.13 ERA in the month of September.
Yeah.
Whereas Eovaldi is right around where his current ERA is. It's 3.94.
Okay.
So what do you think? Like, honestly, I think that Boston, it's one game. Like, they could take it.
It's absolutely one game. You know, I mean, and it's so, that's why, like, this, I look at this and I see it as kind of a coin flip. Because anything can happen, right? We were talking about Ryu and how Ryu's been Garbogian. And then he comes out today and looks pretty solid. Like, gives up a few, but still very solid from him. Yeah. I wouldn't be surprised at any given moment if Gerrit Cole wanted to come out and throw six scoreless.
Yeah.
However, when you look at what he's done for me lately, like, hasn't been great.
Yeah,
so.
like I think Vegas is going to have Yankees as the favorites. Mm. I feel like Yankees, well, I mean, like, they're literally identical reticards, but it's Gerrit Cole going, right? So I feel like he's going to have a slight favorite. But for me, honestly, I would not be shocked at all.
No.
If Boston moves on and faces Tampa Bay in the division series.
Yeah, yeah. Question for you. Yeah. These two teams, you know, who do you like long term? Whoever wins
I like the Yankees longer because it's the pitching for me with the Red Sox.
Yes.
Like, it's just not going to be good enough. Like, if they do win, Tampa Bay is going to have them, no problem. They're going to handle them.
I don't want to say it's no problem, but I would agree that I think that Tampa Bay would probably have them. Just based on those pitching matchups.
Yep.
At the end of the day, I always look at pitching during the series. I think that is the most important thing. So Yankees do have a better team pitching staff. We'll see if Gerrit Cole can hold up.
And you know what's funny? It's like when I talk about Tampa Bay Rays pitching, I'm like, oh yeah, definitely they have a better pitching than the Boston Red Sox and New York Yankees.
I'm like,
I can't name Yarborough.
Yeah.
Walker. They all are bad. They have that one guy that's good. I don't know who he is.
I don't understand.
But it's better than Chris Sale and Eovaldi. It's better than Cole and Montgomery.
Doesn't make sense, man.
What?
Yeah.
But yeah,
I don't get it. I still don't get it. I'm still probably going to underrate the Rays next year just because I still don't understand, and I'm probably going to be wrong again.
Right.
Because it doesn't make any goddamn sense. One of these seasons. I might be right, though,
and
I'm going to be really happy when that season does come because I'm so sick and tired of these guys
100
just
wins.
Literally, like, doing fucking wins. Voodoo. Like, you know, it's like you got some witch doctor in the back, like, just, like, cursing other teams with their fucking voodoo dolls and stuff.
Mm.
And it's like, you know, wow,
right,
like, now this guy that I have no idea about is now suddenly elite because all he does is throw sliders outside, and for some reason, we swing at them. I don't know, man.
I don't understand.
I'm
pissed
off.
They know.
We're off topic now.
Yeah, we're a little
bit. I'm not sure who wins this game, but I would take the Yankees longer term, I think.
Yes.
But I would honestly, guys, bet the underdog on this game.
I might do the Red Sox, assuming they're the underdogs. Speaking of making it into the postseason, Dodgers are definitely there.
They're locked it down. Dude.
They're in a wild card.
The fact that they're a wild card
team. They're a wild card team.
Is ridiculous.
Kind of crazy.
GG.
Yeah.
San Francisco Giants.
Congratulations.
You guys deserve the biggest of
shout
outs.
For real. But they took a big blow today in game 162. Blow, Max Muncy's elbow got collision at first base, and it did not look good. Mm. Reports from the manager saying he's definitely not going to play in the wild card game, and it's not sure about playing in the division series either.
Well
you got to get there first. So
first things first, they have to win their game against the red hot St. Louis Cardinals. So that's a whole
that's a whole thing.
But Max Muncy, that's huge man. He did not look good on the field, which is weird because the whole running injury itself, like, it looked like one of those things that it could have been nothing, but then, like, I guess it just got him in a weird spot, and he was like on the ground kind of screaming and not looking too hot. So
I would
honestly could see Max Muncy maybe not even playing at all for the rest of the year, which is massive because he's got an OPS of 897, one of their best hitters this year, and he's played the third most ABs. He's been a lock at first base. And now the Dodgers are going to have to look inwardly and go, okay, who the hell is going to play at first base?
Oh, God.
And, I mean, the two options that I see, Dodgers, please correct me in the chat, if there's someone else here that you're going to move around, I'm not sure. But it looks like Pujols and it looks like Cody Bellinger are kind of the options, man.
And for me personally, I'm going Pujols over Bellinger. I don't even know if Bellinger's even starting for you.
I don't even know, man.
I don't even know. This guy has had a horrible year. What's his OPS? You had it.
539. And I think that his batting average is something like 167 or like 168.
So bad, man.
Like it is
how did
ridiculous.
That happen? Dodgers fans, let us know. How did this happen, man?
Yeah.
I am confused. This guy was an MVP 2 years ago. What the hell happened? I know he changed his swing.
Well,
and that's kind of when things started sucking.
I remember when I did a video breakdown of Cody Bellinger, the main thing was he just cannot catch up to the fastball anymore.
What happened?
You throw it in the zone, and if it's above like 92 miles per hour, it is impossible for this guy to hit. Like, he just cannot do it, which is ridiculous because in that MVP year, and when you are an MVP, you kind of have to hit the bloody fastball. He hit it phenomenally with something like, you know, a 360 batting average against, and then just immediately the second, and it was the All-Star break too, dude. And that MVP year, it was like from that All-Star break, it's been like a slow decline.
Right,
and like now we are at the bottom pit of the floor. Wow. Ever since then, he's been a completely different guy.
Yeah, that's incredible. So I don't want him starting. I want Albert Pujols because he's actually been not that bad, and he's a veteran. No. Come on, like,
he's
why don't you
pretty good,
put him
dude.
In?
769 OPS on Albert Pujols. I mean, I'm still 100% totally worried about this Dodgers team. I still think that this Dodgers team can go, like, the sky is always the limit when you're rocking with Max Scherzer and Walker Buehler.
Yes.
But I wouldn't also be shocked if the St. Louis Cardinals, being as hot as they are, can just knock these guys off.
That's
It is one game.
For me, it's like I almost like I want to say, no, it's the Dodgers. It's the Dodgers. Just like how I told myself, it's the Blue Jays. It's the Blue Jays. We're making it.
Yes, totally.
But it could literally happen either way.
It can happen either way, dude. I mean, again, I'm probably more scared of Dodgers long term because of the pitching, but there goes our flag. But at the same time, it's like these St. Louis Cardinals, momentum. Would not be shocked if they beat these guys and then just like started going on a run with it.
Now, moving on to a guy who is going to be an MVP this year. Mm. Not Cody Bellinger. He's way in the past.
No.
Shohei Ohtani has told media that he is interested in a contract extension with the L.A. Angels. So holy crap.
Yeah.
First of all, let's take a look at what Shohei is currently making for a dude who's an ace and an MVP, Silver Slugger, anything, really.
Yeah.
You can just name it. This year, he's only making $3 million, I believe it was. $3 million this year.
That low, dude.
Next year, he's making $5.5 million. And then in 2023, he's an arbitration. But then he hits free agency. So, yeah, contract extension's coming up.
Buddy, if I am the LA Angels, you have to lock him down. If he is showing any remote interest in your team long term, you have to lock him down.
Yes.
He's 27 years old. He is the best player in baseball right now by a sizable margin, especially when you're looking at WAR.
8.9 WAR.
8.9
Just destroying
WAR.
Baseball.
Destroying it, dude. If this guy has any interest in being on your team long term, which is kind of shocking to me, because if I'm Shohei Ohtani, I want to be pitching game 7 on a crazy team because every team and their dog is going to want me.
Yeah.
But you know what?
Hey, The dude said, I love the city and I love the fans.
He loves the city. He loves the fans. And he loves it so much that he's going to hit 45 home runs for you, steal 26 bags, have over 100 runs scored, 99 ribbies, have an OPS of 959, and then also throw 130.1 innings pitched and amass 156 strikeouts with a 3.18 ERA along the way.
Yeah.
How much money is this freaking guy going to make?
Dude,
too much.
This guy is going, and I honestly think, he might take a pay cut because he wants to live in L.A., but I think this man deserves to be the highest paid player in baseball.
Oh, he absolutely, dude. You know? I think he has to be, though. I don't think because there's any way around it.
You're combining an ace and you're combining the MVP. It's like you're combining a guy who could win Cy Young one day and then a guy who's literally about to win MVP.
Yes.
Like, you're like, what?
Literally.
What?
Literally. And it's also, too, 27 years old. Like, this
is
prime time to be hitting the extension market, you know?
Yes.
You can lock him down and feel very comfortable with a 10-year deal on this guy, you know? And
he's a tank. He's going to last it, too.
And that's the thing, you know? Eventually, is he still going to be throwing 130 innings and doing all this, like, when he's 35? Probably not. I mean, we don't know.
So
maybe he literally is the best player
in baseball
of all time, and he's doing that, but...
For me, then what I would do is I'd front load that contract, because if you got to assume that, like, just like with George Springer, we didn't front load the contract, but you pay him more in the years that he's supposed to do more, and then it kind of falls out the rest of the way. So I think you got to front load that contract, and then as he gets older, maybe just becomes hitter only, because that's what Babe Ruth did, right?
Yeah.
You can't be a pitcher and a hitter your whole career. You're going to die.
Well, that's the thing. If he did, he would be the best player in baseball of all time ever.
Do you think he will?
I mean, I don't know. I didn't think that this guy would do this. So it's like, even knows, dude? But this guy is going to get paid like $350+ million, I think, you know, on a deal.
That's
for sure.
That's floor for me. $350
floor,
at least.
It's like this guy could even push like the 400 mark.
Could even.
Depending on the years and that average annual value. But the average annual value is going to be like 100% over $30 million, in my opinion. Like when you're looking at contracts like Gerrit Cole and Francisco Lindor, like those are like floor
in my mind. Yep.
I expect it to be.
Because if you do better than those guys, you deserve more. And he's doing better than those guys.
Like, as far
in
as
a way,
like, war,
you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
War, right?
Yes,
100%. So I get more.
Yes.
That's just what it is.
Yes.
So.
And also, too, there's a whole other element that we don't even talk about with this guy, is that he is literally the most marketable player in all of baseball.
Right. You know? He's Babe Ruth.
He's literally
Babe Ruth being reborn.
And it's so clear when you look at the analytics and the numbers, it's like so many Japanese viewers watch Shohei Ohtani.
Yes, they
the
do.
Amount of jersey sales, the amount of merchandise that the LA Angels have literally brought in from Shohei Ohtani. Like he practically pays for him fucking self.
Dude, we might get an Ohtani shirt in our background.
Literally.
We're gonna do it for like when we're talking more baseball stuff.
Exactly.
That'd be dope.
You know, and it's like that alone, obviously it's not going to pay like three, maybe it will, I don't know, but it's like just having that and just doing that, it's like he literally will help pay for his own contract.
Yep,
he's going to get paid the bag, re-sign with LA, I guess, if you want. If you
Absolutely.
Want to come to the Blue Jays, though, we'll also give it
we'll
to you.
We'll also give it to you.
Yes,
yes. Yeah. Well, guys, speaking of the Blue Jays, I think it's a good time to kind of transition.
Are we doing this
now? Yeah, we are.
Let's do it.
Yeah, I'm just
warming myself up for this right now.
Okay. Well, so for those who missed our post-game kind of reaction, right, we're going to kind of summarize some of those things. Mm. Blue Jays, look, they went 4-2 this week, but the thing is what's going to be different about this Blue Jays Today Show breakdown is that we're literally done. The season is literally over. The Blue Jays just missed postseason by one game, and it came down to that Rafael Devers home run that we were talking about earlier. We were so close. Tell me your thoughts, Nick, about just the season or even just this last day.
Cole's notes, guys. Frankly, we did pretty much what we thought we had to. Like, I think that we talked about, you know, we might have to. Or did we say 5-1 this week? We had to go 5-1.
5-1 was probably what we had to do,
Well, that is the case. You know, because we went 4-2, which is still decent, but wasn't enough, right?
Just short.
So that's too bad. It felt like we were gearing up that way for the entire year, though. That pretty much everything we did was just a little bit too short. You know, we acquired the guys just a little bit too late. We missed the home run just by a little bit too little. Mm-hmm. You know, we missed the error on just a little bit. So it felt the whole time we were just a little bit off. We didn't get hot until a little bit too late. Mm-hmm. So just all these things was gearing up for that one, two games back, sort of. We missed the thing, and it happened, and it sucks.
Yeah.
As far as the whole season goes, I cannot complain about almost anything. But this is obviously the mark of a successful season.
No, this was successful. And like obviously making that 163, because that's what it came down to, guys, on this last Sunday, is that you had to win, and we did. We crushed Baltimore 12-4, but you had to get either a Yankees loss or a Boston Red Sox loss. Judge, walk-off single on the ninth, won it. Devers, go ahead, 2-run blast. They actually came back from 5-1 for those who missed it. They tied the game 5-5. Then they went on to win 7-5.
Wow,
so,
you know what? It's got to feel amazing to be a Boston fan.
Oh, hell yeah.
Can you imagine if that was the Blue Jays and we were doing a live watch along about that?
Yep.
You're sweating your ass off into the seventh. And then now Devers in the ninth comes and saves the day.
Because here's the thing. For them, with a loss, like you just have to play an extra game now. And that sucks ass if you lose that game.
Well, all the risk, though.
Like, I know. Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. It would suck ass, right? But it's like for us, it's life or death, right? That meant more to us than it does to them, I feel, obviously. Because now they still, neither way, they're going to play.
Yeah.
They're playing tomorrow or they're playing Tuesday. Mm. So, I mean, it is what it is. But, yeah, like, I want to comment as well on the whole season. Guys, we cannot be disappointed at all. I know it sucks right now. I'm feeling it. I'm going to feel it, especially watching in this postseason, seeing all the updates about the guys, the comments, the interviews, everything. But it's a good season, and I believe I wrote down we were 38-23 since the game before Berrios first start with the Blue Jays. So a couple days after the trade deadline. So if you take that winning percentage moving forward, we should win 100 games next year. Granted, things are going to change. That's over a shorter sample size. So, you know, next season for me, and we're definitely going to talk about this a lot in the offseason, what are we going to do, what do we have to do, et cetera, et cetera. For me, my expectations as of right now is you make a postseason spot, 94 wins.
You have
94 wins.
No, you definitely have to, right?
Three more wins in this year.
We're still on schedule. We're still doing what we have to do, and we got the big breakouts. And now coming into next year, even if we are down a Robbie Ray or down a Marcus Semien, we have to be considered an elite squad. Nonetheless, I know it's not going to be as nice, but it's like we have to be considered an elite squad. It does suck, though. It really does suck, though, that all of these amazing years kind of got, and I don't want to say wasted, but a little bit in a sense, right? Because it's like if you don't get Marcus Semien back and if you don't get Robbie Ray back, then what was that all for? Yeah. What was that all for? Like, yes, it was great to watch, but at the end of the day, we didn't really get the results needed.
Well, you know, the only way to look at that, because I know you're talking about the Vladdy second in MVP year, Robbie Ray will win the Cy Young, and then Marcus Semien breaking second baseman records with home runs. But for me, it's like you can only go up from here. Maybe Vladdy's not going to do it again. He could. Mm. He's 22. He'll be 23 next year. You know, yes, maybe we sign Robbie Ray, but Alek Manoah, Nate Pearson looking good out of the bullpen. There's guys that can improve. Lourdes Gurriel Jr. maybe gets off to a much better start. Mm-hmm. Tio, maybe he's still really good next year. He keeps it up with his Silver Slugger ways. George Springer, fully healthy. Mm-hmm. We were just seeing at the end. He had a great week this week. We were just seeing at the end what he could do, and I bet he was trying even harder because he wanted to make up, and he looked fully healthy.
Yeah.
You know, so
no, I
it's only
hear you,
up
dude.
From here.
I hear you. However, there is also a narrative, and I have to say it, it could be down from here if Vladdy doesn't do that again. And how often you get a second baseman do that? Literally never.
Yeah.
This is the only time ever. How often do you have the Cy Young? Not that often. I don't remember the last Blue Jays Cy Young, a long bloody time ago, right? So it's like you don't get those things very often. Now, you also don't get a horrible bullpen that blows games very often. So maybe what we lose in some areas, we make up in other areas, and we just have to cross our fingers that is going to be the case.
And I think it's going to be. I think it's going to be. Like, how I don't really see, there is the reality, like you're saying, where we just miss playoffs. But, I can't believe that. I'm not going to allow myself
to believe
that.
It's also too early as well.
It's way too early. We don't even know what the offseason moves are, right?
We don't know what our team's going to look like. We're going to have to take some time, step away, and then we'll start reevaluating, looking at some player breakdowns. But it is disappointing that a Cy Young Robbie Ray year, that a almost MVP year, that
should
a
have
record
been
breaking Marcus Semien
Otani
year,
yeah,
that some crazy good offense was not enough to make the postseason. That's too bad. Hopefully, like you said, it is a building block,
yeah,
and we can move on next year.
And we're going to talk about a lot, guys. Like, we want to, obviously, this show is only so long, but all throughout the offseason, we're going to be talking about this, so stay tuned for that.
Yeah, yeah.
But I do want to congratulate one last time.
The final time, bro.
The final J.
Yes.
Of the week. Do your thing. I said it, but do
yeah,
it.
I would appreciate that. This is Go my ahead. Last this time, Adam. It. Don't steal my goddamn moment, bro.
Do
it's
it.
Time for the J of the week. All right, everybody. The final J of the week for the 2021 MLB season on your Toronto Blue Jays. I'm very happy to announce that the $150 million was not completely in waste. It goes to George Springer. There you go,
yes.
Big dog.
Yes.
Thank you, George H.
Thank you, man. I mean, yeah, you really showed up this last week. Like, he helped us push to get to where we were a game back. He went 13 for 26. That's a .500 batting average. He slugged .961, an OPS of 1.497. Three homers, 10 RBIs, 8 runs scored.
That's pretty good.
He looked healthy, and that's what's messed up. You know, if he didn't have all these injuries, we could speculate all day long. We had 4 guys hit over 100 RBIs,
yeah.
6 guys hit over 80. I guarantee you'd have 7 in there, maybe
Probably.
Even 5 over 100 yeah. RBIs,
yeah.
too.
Very possible. At the end of the day, when you look at the slash line, that OPS was over 900 when he finished the year.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I can't say 100% that we're going to get that next season, but I think odds are pretty good if he is fully healthy and ready to go. That is key. He's going to have a great offseason, making sure that he's conditioning properly.
Yes.
Because, yes, he is getting up there in the age. He'll be 32. That doesn't mean any decline,
mm-hmm.
but you have to take more care of your body when you're that age. But a healthy George Springer, it should be amazing next season. Yeah,
absolutely. So thank you, George.
Thank you, George.
And here's the part of our show where we usually talk about the next week, but because there is no next
There's
week for
no
the Toronto
next
Blue
week.
Jays,
There's no next week.
We can just move on and talk about our wheel.
We can talk about our wheel, guys. Let's do it. The spinning fortune baseball colorful future determining stat analyzing and it's a wheel that we spin every week. Okay, everybody. So there is no spinning of the wheel this week because last week was the final spin. And similarly to the Blue Jay season, this one was a roller coaster for us as well. Let us know.
Nicholas has won. The wheel of stats analyzing, baseball colorful, yada, 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 blah, blah, that wheel. So congratulations,
wheel.
Nick.
Thank you, man. GG.
GG.
It was well fought,
that
dude.
That was a good, good battle. 36 to 33 is the final score. I really liked that wheel. That was a lot of fun.
It really was, dude.
You know?
And I'm happy that it wasn't a complete blowout. It
felt
like it was going to be at the top. You really took that early lead.
Yeah.
And we crawled our way back in. And you know what? To finish 36 to 33, that was exciting the whole
Yeah.
It really did actually come down to this last week.
It did, yeah, because I had to at least get 2 categories. If we were to split one, then I would tie it. Sweeping you, I'd win. However, how it went down is for Jay, worst Jay of the week, I picked Randall, you picked McGuire, who only had 3 at-bats.
Yeah, McGuire
so
did not
name.
Play like at all this week.
Yeah.
It was the Danny Jansen and Alejandro Kirk show, as it should be
as
moving
should
forward.
Be.
That's a whole other podcast
nudge.
We'll be talking about.
Yeah, and then for home runs, I picked, I believe, I picked Semien.
You picked
Vlad.
I picked Vlad.
Both hit 2.
Nice.
X-nade, right? So at that point, it's pretty much GG. No matter what, you got the last category. Semien with 4 runs scored. I picked Vladdy with 3.
Yeah.
And that was it. That's
and
all
that
she wrote.
Was it, dude? So that was the first thing. I mean, yeah, we should have like a tiny little like a trophy of
we
some
should,
kind,
you
know?
Know?
Kind of like on NFL Network how they have their little season-ending like things.
Well,
you
maybe as we go into it next year, it's like because these, you know, how you present all the awards in the following season.
Dude.
You're like, here's the champion
all
from the
right,
wheel.
All right. Yeah, I like it,
yeah,
man.
Yeah.
You know, and if you guys like the wheel, then let us know.
Mm-hmm.
I think we'll definitely be doing that, but having some more like little
different categories.
We or like things.
Or different and games
stuff.
And shit. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
Locks of the week. Yeah. And I think that'd be really fun for next year.
Because this is our first blue, like our first like show where we had a bit of structure and we followed the same kind of formula. But like, yeah, now that we're going in the off season, we're kind of just gonna like. We're going to mess around. Like,
we're
going to
mess around
I mean?
And play with some things, guys. Yeah, so, yeah. But yes, for the first wheel season, I am the crown champion.
Nice.
And it was a lot of fun.
Yes.
So I hope that you guys liked playing along with that.
Yes.
That's pretty much it, my friend.
Shorter show,
that
I
is
think.
The shorter show.
Well, I mean, we did spend a long time in the beginning talking about stuff.
Yeah, we did. But we're not entirely sure yet if this show will continue moving forward or what we're going to do. We're kind of, like we said, play around with some stuff and see what makes sense. But we will have a lot more content. That's
yes.
For sure.
Oh, yeah. We're going to be pumping up podcasts constantly. And during this next month, guys, in October, we're going to be doing watch-alongs for the postseason game. So I hope to see you guys all there. We're hopping on some bandwagons. Brewers in Boston. We're hoping that they can make it happen.
Yes.
As well, guys, like, yeah, in terms of the shows, like, I feel like we can do a wine on wines.
Totally.
We're
doing
some late night wine
on
wines.
I'm still going to be drinking the wine anyway, so I might as well be answering some questions. While we do it.
Yeah, and I think that the Blue Jays Today show, you know, we could just do like recaps, summaries of like the postseason, any rumors, especially in the offseason too, after postseason, want to be like covering. Like, we're going to be your guys covering the offseason, all the rumors.
There will be a lot.
Everything.
So, with all that being said, guys, please make sure to like and subscribe to this channel if you are new. Today, Jace is our coach for Monkey Knife Fighting for Manscaped. Those are both core sponsors, so hop onto them. $3 a month, and you can become a Patreon like all of these beautiful people. Look at all these lovely Patreons.
That's incredible.
That is amazing. And also, too, just the biggest of shout-outs to you guys for watching us during this time. This has been an awesome season of baseball for the Blue Jays, for everything. Mm-hmm. We've made so many new friends on this platform, had so many new subscribers, so many new viewers, so many lovely donations, so many lovely Patreons, and just such an overall great time watching the games with you and making content. So more of that to come for sure. Shout out and thank you to you guys.
And guys, here's to moving on to better things. Blue Jay season in 2022 is gonna be the one, baby.
It'll be the one, man.
Let's go, Jay.
Book it right now, guys. Book it right now.
Book your tickets to the AL Wildcard where we're hosting. Maybe even the division series where we win. Guys, thank you so much for watching. Oh, go Jays, go!